Okay, so what I've learned after living sustainably for 5-ish years, or really what I'm trying to say is trying to live sustainably, but YouTube prefers a more self-assured title, so there we have it. If you like this video and you're new here, then hit that subscribe button and the notification bell so that you never miss another video. And while you're at it, give the video a like if you do like it. But in the meantime, grab a cup of tea, coffee, whatever you like, and let's just get straight into the video. So, the first thing that I learned, well, one of the things that I've learned, are mistakes are something we should actively strive for rather than trying to get everything right and trying to be perfectionist about a singular journey. Because there's absolutely no learning opportunity if we're just trying to get everything right. But if we just allow ourselves to make mistakes, have slip-ups, say the wrong words, then this is the perfect way that we can learn from experience and we'll have that memory rather than something we've just read somewhere or kind of learnt but not really tried out ourselves. And I think there were several things that prevented me from doing this in the first place. Firstly, I was so young and naive when I tried to live sustainably and trying to be perfectly zero waste and vegan and all these different things. I was so scared to fail so openly and so publicly, and I just didn't want to be called out for it because I wasn't emotionally mature enough to be able to handle that, learn from that, and improve myself that way. I had no faith in myself, I had no confidence in myself and my abilities to adapt and learn, and no confidence that mistakes were perfectly normal and that they were encouraged and the best foundation on which we can build our skills and our knowledge. Of course, you can bypass many mistakes by you know doing your homework, by listening, by reading, by following a diverse range of influences, by reading books widely by a diverse range of authors. There are so many ways that we can do it, but nothing beats experience for cementing in a new habit, a new idea, or a new way of living in our brains. Perfection is so overrated. So from now on, I've been striving for mistakes rather than perfection. The second thing that I've learned is to remain humble and curious every time I learn something new. I have this tendency to take something that I've learned and just get so excited about it, treat it as gospel, and try and spread that information way too far and wide. When really I should sit with things a little longer, listen to what others have learned, what others think about it, what others have seen and heard, and look for more sources of information, more questioning, keep pushing gently towards bettering that knowledge, finding alternative opinions or research or understanding of a topic so I can really fully develop my understanding of something by having a much wider picture. I've learned that being judgmental is incredibly lonely and it doesn't inspire other people to confide in you when they have been inspired by you to live more sustainably, eat a few vegan meals or anything like that, give up fast fashion, etc. In my experience, judgment has also always seem to do more harm than good. I'm almost certain that the majority of my followers are not vegan, but what good would it be for me to sit here and act as though I knew every little, you know, thing about your circumstances, about your background, your understanding of food, your education on food, your accessibility to vegan food in particular, and tell you that you're a bad person because you don't eat the way that I do. I would much rather gently offer you options rather than alienate you by appearing judgmental and mean. Food is such an innately intimate subject. It's tied up with culture and family, with our emotions and ways of coping with life, with our own self-image and what society tells us we should look like, how we should eat, and what we shouldn't. You'll never hear me say that you are not welcome here because you do not eat a plant-based diet. I've learned that being judgmental is lonely, and I would much rather be surrounded by a community who respects me because I'm kind and compassionate, and not because I've bullied you into something or forced you to feel guilty about that. This might be an unpopular opinion when to other vegans, but I'm not here to be judgmental at all. I hate that. I am here to be compassionate. I call myself an ethical vegan. What good would it do for me to be judgmental when there is absolutely, well, in my opinion, no need for it. The amount of comments I've got from people saying that they've tried a vegan diet or they've tried eating more plant-based or incorporated a few more plant-based meals because of my gentle approach is just incredible. So I have my approach. That's what I like to do. And I'm not here to be judgmental. I love you for who you are, for what you do. Any effort I personally think should be absolutely celebrated. I learned to really zoom out and see the much bigger picture. Now, this can be really difficult, but it is a habit worth practicing. For example, I thought that by just going vegan, I'd be instantly making the most sustainable choice, but I didn't take into consideration things like transport, food miles, locality, seasonality, soil health, regenerative agriculture, all of these different things. I was so naive and so ignorant of when I first started this way of eating, of living, that I had no idea what actually eating a sustainably, what eating a way that was more sustainable actually meant. Now, we all come from a place of ignorance when we learn something new, and that's perfectly fine. But this is why I think it's so important to stay curious, keep questioning, keep trying to better understand the choices that you're making and why they're right for you, but also, is there a bigger picture that we're not looking at? Is there a wider stance that we could be looking at? I've learned that I will never DIY my own skincare ever again, except perhaps maybe the odd face mask, but for me, I know that that's just for fun rather than getting any actual benefits from it. Now, this might be a controversial one, but I stand by it. My DIY skincare that I did were not good, more expensive, and often more wasteful. None of the DIY recipes that I tried from various things I found on the internet were formulated by experts, were tested on different skin types to make sure that they were safe. This is the number one reason why I've taken down all of my DIY sort of recipe videos from a few years ago. The only one I still have up is my shampoo bar recipe that I put up a couple of weeks ago, but that's just because it was, you know, in collaboration with a company that are experts in this area and helped me to formulate a proper, you know, safe recipe that I could share with you guys with the knowledge it had been checked out by people who know what they're doing. It actually upsets and annoys me that I really bought into DIY skincare at the very beginning. And for those of you who use DIY skincare, this might be an unpopular opinion, but I'm not young anymore. Well, I am relatively young, but I'm not so young that it doesn't matter what I put on my skin. I want to take care of my skin. My skin is my biggest organ. I want to make sure that I am treating it with respect. I am treating it with what it deserves and not just putting, like, I don't know, tea tree oil on my face and calling it a day, you know? I want to make sure that I'm not putting something potentially dangerous and irritating onto my skin. I want formulated things by experts, and yeah, I'm never going to be DIYing my skincare ever again. You heard it here first. I don't care if this is an unpopular opinion. I think it's irresponsible. My old videos of DIY skincare, I think, are irresponsible. I've learned that labels suck, and it encourages other people to judge you for your actions, your personal choices, and puts you on a pedestal that you will inevitably completely fall off and come crashing down from. We should view these labels like zero waste, low impact, whatever, minimalist, as just simply guidelines. And if I were you, I wouldn't put a label on yourself, because it does, as I said, encourage people to judge you for your actions, despite the fact that they may not be trying at all to be more sustainable, to eat less meat, blah, blah, blah. It's so much better to just do things than to say, I am this, I am that. And yeah, that's a regret of mine. I wish I hadn't put any labels on anything that I have done, because it opens you up to a lot more criticism, and that can suck. Following trends is always a mistake. When we buy on trend, we're not necessarily taking into consideration our actual preferences, perhaps the long-term utility of that item, whether it goes with any of the other kind of stuff that we have. My coffee cup is a perfect example of this. I bought a Keep cup several years ago when they were sort of all the rage and everyone was loving them. And while I did love it, it was a beautiful cup, it was cool, it helped me, I used it every single day. I'm clumsy. And why didn't I take this into consideration when I bought this? I bought a glass Keep cup and I am clumsy. I mean, what was I thinking? So inevitably what happened was queuing up to buy a coffee from a coffee shop, and I was holding it in my arm here, but must have been looking through stuff, and suddenly this smash, and I was looking around being like, oh my god, what's happened? And everyone was staring directly at me, and then I looked down and I was just surrounded by pieces of glass, and I was devastated. It was so embarrassing. So what did I do instead? I opted for something that I found myself, that I didn't see anywhere, that I just wanted to, you know, make sure was clumsy proof, Emmy proof. So I got a stainless steel one. Have I ever broken it? No. Have I dropped it? Oh, many times, but it's still perfectly usable. So don't buy things that are on trend, or I wish that I hadn't bought things that are on trend. Buy things that are actually suited to your needs, your preferences. How, you know, does it have long-term utility? Is it going to be a cumbersome and annoying? Is it going to actually help you, or is it going to hinder you? I've learned that climate justice should be intersectional, and those who are often ignored, their voices should be uplifted, because a lot of the time, if not always, those people or those communities are the ones most affected by things like climate justice, by the waste pandemic, by plastic pollution. Last year I read Braiding Sweetgrass by Robin Wall Kimmerer, and it basically left this massive gaping hole in my sustainability journey and the knowledge that I had about food, about indigenous wisdom, and who the really, you know, who we should really be looking to for advice on how to fight climate change. Her book gave me a better understanding of how indigenous people live in harmony with nature and understand its needs far better than I ever could. And I've learned that often the more impactful thing that I can do as somebody in this movement with a platform is to step aside and give someone who is far more knowledgeable the mic to actually talk. I've learned that every action and interaction we have, however small, can have a huge impact on those around us. So while I am a huge proponent of system change, I also really believe in consumer power and the importance that individual actions can have on generations of invested people fighting for our futures and in shaping culture so that true change can happen. Of course, I strongly believe in policy change to hold carbon-intensive companies accountable, but we cannot underestimate grassroots organizations and the power that they have to change the way that everyday people view themselves and their place in this fight. Intersectional environmentalists are a perfect example of how a group of intelligent and energized people started a whole wave of movement and action towards creating a world where equality is possible and our futures are waiting. I've learned that community is everything. Sharing the moment when you've created a new habit, cemented those composting structures in your home, or grown your own beautiful first red strawberry from a small pot that you planted several months ago. That's pure elation. I've learned that living sustainably has to be sustainable. The most obvious thing, and yet the thing that we all overlook when we're trying to start a new lifestyle, improve our habits, you know, build new habits, making them sustainable is something that we overlook all the goddamn time. Slow and steady is the best way to start any kind of behavior change. I talk about behavior change all the time because I think it's so important. If we understand our behaviors, then we can change them. If we start slow and steady and sustainably, they'll go on forever. There's no point in jumping into everything too fast, etc. It's so important that we start small and steady. If you're looking for a video on how to do this, I've made one about how tiny habits are transformative. Also just like how to build new habits, etc. Like that's going to be here if you want it. But in the grand scheme of things, five years isn't really a long time, though it has felt like the most incredible long and bumpy road, let me tell you that. I'm incredibly thankful for the community that I found online. I've learned more in the last 1 year than the first four, and it's because I spoke to people, it's because I listened to you, it's because I asked for feedback and I actually implemented that feedback. I don't want to be someone who spreads misinformation, or I don't want to be someone that's ignorant to the importance of passing the microphone to someone who is much more well-versed in these things. That's why on particularly Instagram, I am always promoting other influencers who have more important things to say than me. Sometimes the best thing is to uplift someone else's voice and just shut up yourself. I'm going to be leaving some names of influencers who I think you should really be watching and listening to in the description. So that's what I've learned over the last 5 years. I've learned quite a few more things, obviously, but I felt like those were the most impactful and important to say. I want to thank you for being here, for taking this journey with me, for always calling me out when I do something that's stupid, for giving me great tips on cooking, for telling me, you know, it's not okay to say X and this is why. Do better. I think if we're scared of being called out for things, then we tend to be too safe and too much in our own bubbles. But really, if you're going to put content online, you need to be brave. You need to stand out, and you really need to just build your own opinions and build your own mind. That's what I personally think. So happy Sunday, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something. If you did, let me know what it was. And I would love to know what you learned over the past however many years you've been on your sustainable journey. If you're looking for something next to watch, then why not check out my 100 series where I give you lots of different topics to look at, like reducing food waste, zero waste, swaps, you know, things to reuse and repurpose, and so on. But for now, thank you so much for watching. I will see you very soon. Bye.